the crowd go. Touch this. And it started with a little kiss like this.
A Tribe Called Quest.
Hip-hop music has been with us for more than 20 years now. But what most of us haven't realized is how big it's become. Today, hip-hop outsells every other type of music. It's bigger than R&B, bigger than country, even bigger than rock. Forget the rock and roll years. What we're living in now are the hip-hop years. Hip-hop owes its beginnings to a particular place and a particular time. The place was the South Bronx, and the time was the 1970s. The South Bronx was a notorious borough of New York City, marked by some of the worst levels of unemployment, dereliction, and violent crime in America.
You had a lot of gang activity that was happening in the Bronx back in the late 60s, early 70s. You had a lot of drugs in the communities, a lot of violence and robberies, things was going on. The Bronx was called one of the destructive areas of the town.
While life in the city had become tougher, mainstream black music in the 70s had softened into the ultimate form of crossover pop, disco. The generation growing up in the Bronx in the 70s found that music like disco was wildly out of step with the reality of their lives.
It was something that seemed very far away from what ghetto kid on the street could realistically hope to attain or to be a part of. That whole idea of the flashy, the gaudy, the costume, all that stuff was something that hip-hop reacted against.
I guess we wasn't enough high society to be down with the disco, John Travolta dancing and all that. You know what I'm saying? So we created our own, you know what I'm saying? We created our own parties.
Hip-hop's genesis can be traced to this inconspicuous housing project on the edge of the South Bronx. It was here that hip-hop's founding father, DJ Kool Herc, built his first sound system in 1971.
1520 Cedric Avenue, the historic birthland of the culture they call hip-hop music. My room in the back, and this was the landing. When I used to play music in my room, the kids used to be back here hanging out, chilling. And when I start to play the music, everybody start to do their little stuff and break dance and all that type of stuff right here. So there's a recreation room for the building. You rent the room. That's what we did. So this was a breath of fresh air for us, going somewhere we could hear some music. Turned out to be a success.
Herc was one of the first DJs in the Bronx to borrow a technique from Manhattan's downtown discotheques, the use of two turntables. This meant DJs could play music without interruption, mixing from the end of one record straight into the beginning of another. But unlike other DJs, Herc didn't play disco music. Instead, he specialized in the kind of hard-edged funk music that others ignored.
Yeah, I remember going to the Herc parties, and this started in the community room, and it grew so big that we couldn't fit in the community room anymore. And music was just, it was slamming. I was trying to think about what would be, synonymous with a cool Herc party. And it would have to be James Brown, clap your hands, stomp your feet. It wasn't a cool Herc party.
Without have a very party
yeah, exactly.
What singled out Herc as a DJ was his keen eye for crowd reaction. He noticed that the energy on the dance floor hits a peak during the instrumental breaks in the records, the point when the singing stops and the music carries on. From this simple observation, Herc came up with an idea that would become the basis of hip-hop.
One night, I'm waiting for the record to play out. I said, I wonder if I put that to myself. I said, if they're waiting for this particular break and I have a couple more records that's got the same breakup in it, I wonder how would it be if I put them all together. And I told them, I said, I'm gonna try something new tonight. I'm gonna call it a merry-go-round.
Herc's merry-go-round meant that instead of playing whole records, he would play just the instrumental breaks, mixing between them to create a continuous dance rhythm.
Started out with James Brown, clap your hand, stomp your feet. That part right there, when the break, boom, I had to come in with Bongo Rock. Still no vocals in it, then I will go into Baby Huey, the Mexican. And it was like, whoa, I think we got some hit, because people was like, oh, whoa. Everybody was like, yeah, I'm feeling this. Oh, yeah.
The instrumental breaks on the records became known as the breakbeats, and Herc's merry-go-round formula of mixing between them provided the blueprint for a new music.
Oh man, Cool Herc was the first person I ever heard that do anything like that, Because I'm used to being in the house with my mother and we pull a James Brown record on and just let it play through. Cool Herc would play the break part back and forth, and that really astonished me. I was really impressed when I seen that, something like that, because I'd never seen anything like that before.
I saw Cool Herc. And I was 14 years old, and that very day when I saw his sound system and how loud it was and the records that he played would just change the way the party was going, and that's what I wanted to do for life.
As Cool Herc's celebrity spread through the South Bronx in the early 70s, a new dance attached itself to the music he created. The music didn't even have a name yet. The new dance did. It was called b-boying, later to become known as breakdancing. Feel the groove, and there's
something gonna make you move. As hip-hop was being, formed, it was like before it had a name or before we kind of knew what was going on, there were b-boys. There was this new dance, breakdancing.
B-boy and b-girl comes from Cool Herc. B meaning break. Okay, break boy, you dance on the break. That's it. The break beats were for the B-boys. When Cool Herc was throwing on break beats, he would say, B-boys, are you ready? B-girls, are you ready? And that meant that it was about, about that time, the high point of the jam, where everyone just starts going off.
I got a certain maxim that I made up. Want me to show you it? I put my arm right here, and it's easy, and I push my arm and swing my left leg to my right leg, both of them. Around. Swing the leg.
It It was our outlet and our way of expressing ourselves and showing our individuality, our character, our strength, and our attitude.
I was walking down Fauna Rowan University, which was my block, and I seen these two kids with a boombox. They had the music going, and I seen them, they were hitting the floor. They're doing fancy footwork, and I got stopped. I just stopped to get amazed what they were doing. I was like, wow, that's kind of cool. But I wanted to be, you know, I wanted to be them kids I seen, just the energy they had, and I wanted to catch the energy.
If you had the bones, the flexibility, the strength to do it, you know, made you a hero. I got this knot on my back for trying to duplicate what I seen somebody do back in the days, trying to do some flip thing and land it on my back. Nah, was not cut out for me.
Give it up and turn it loose. Palmer and James Brown's going, clap your hands down. Stomp your feet. Clap your hands down. Stomp your feet. The crowd gets ill when you become part of the music. Like, oh, yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, no, he's killing it, you know?
By the mid-70s, Kool Herc's new music was taking the Bronx by storm. And inevitably, Herc's unique brand of DJing was beginning to attract imitators. The man who would become Herc's biggest rival came out of a neighborhood on the other side of town called the Bronx River Project. This was home to a young gang leader who went by the intriguing name of Afrika Bambaataa.
When I first saw Kool Herc, I said, whoa, they playing a lot of records that I have at home. I said, I like them type of beats he's playing. And then when I came with my full system too, once I got, you know, graduated from high school, then I started saying, oh, this is the style of I'm going to be playing, and then some.
Bambaataa's musical experiments were noisy enough to attract attention.
He's play out the window. I'm riding my bike by this window every day, and I'm hearing, you know what I'm saying, James Brown, you know what I'm saying, all of the good stuff that they ain't playing on the radio. I'm like, okay, I can get with that, because I just wanted to be around that guy.
When Bambaataa became a DJ, he unleashed a new energy into hip-hop. It was an energy that tapped into a frightening force which dominated Bronx life in the 70s. It's street gangs. In an era when the Bronx was rife with savage territorial conflict, Bambaataa was already well known in the area as a notorious gang leader.
At that time, you know, we was part of the gang movement, you know, the Black Spades, the Savage Skulls, the 70 Mortals, the Reapers, all those groups was, you know, controlling the Bronx. And then from my travels and seeing one of my best friends get killed by the police on Pelham Parkway in the Bronx, you know, and seeing how a lot of the brothers and sisters was getting hurt up, that's when I said I had to, you know, try to lead, you know, our organization into another direction.
Bambaataa formed the Zulu Nation, a dedicated following of local hip-hop enthusiasts who organized parties and then put the money they made into community self-help projects.
You gotta understand, you really have to understand that the Zulu Nation had originally been the Black Spades. They were the biggest, most feared gang in the Bronx. I mean, they'd wear these denim jackets with the cut-off sleeves and fur around the collars and Black Spades written across the back. And this was before gangs had a lot of guns, so it was all about getting beat down with D's and with sticks and with knives. I mean, it was brutal. And Bambaataa had the inspiration to stop this gang-banging nonsense, stop killing each other, and let's get creative. So he turned one of the most violent street gangs into one of the most influential cultural organizations. His status was literally legendary. When you heard of Afrika Bambaataa and the Zulu Nation, there was a whole section of the Bronx that was under his command.
Well, the name Zulu Nation inspired me when I seen a movie back in the early 60s which featured Michael Caine called Zulu. That movie just stuck with me. It was just, you know, inspirational seeing the people of Africa fight for what was theirs. I said, you know, one day I'm gonna have me a Zulu nation.
Bambaataa's personal conversion from gang leader to hip-hop DJ set a trend that swept the Bronx. Kids who would previously have joined gangs began channeling their energy into hip-hop, literally taking to the streets with speakers and turntables.
We just went to the nearest light pole and just plugged in and did, you know, and got our juice. You know, and the police used to come by, you know, even though that was illegal, they allowed us to do it, you know what I mean, because it contained us. You know what I mean? They knew that, you know, as long as a block party going on, that's where everybody at.
Lady against that island rock is rock on to the breaking door.
Yo, whoever ain't in rock steady or dynamic, get behind the barriers.
Yo, both rock and cruise, can you please listen? Yo, nobody's listening to me. Rockets, get ready.
Well, the batting was to see who was the competitive artist, who was the more better, who had the better moves, who had the better style.
So who won the rocking contest?
You all know we took them out, right?
The crowd would judge it. And they would just say, who you think won the battle, this guy or this guy? And they were like, is it A or is it B? B, yeah, and then you know, the crowd would just hype it up, yeah, boo.
Who goes for Rocksteady? Dynamic Rockets.
When DJs battled, the crucial factor was having the best breakbeats. And that meant digging up obscure records that your rivals didn't know about. The more unexpected the source of the breakbeat, the better the crowd liked it.
Apache was the it. Apache was the B-boy anthem. It was the highlight of the party.
The battle of wits that was to come would result in a 60s rock guitar band from England becoming the unwitting godfathers of hip-hop. In 1975, hip-hop was still in its infancy. Few outside the South Bronx were even aware of it. There was no such thing as a hip-hop record. The music was made by DJs who took existing records and mixed the breakbeats together to create a new rhythm. Essential to any DJ's craft was the ability to find breakbeats that their rivals didn't have yet.
DJs didn't let other people see what records they had. That was part of the thing of being competitive. You know, who got the beats? And if you got the beats, if it's a competition thing about who got beats, you ain't gonna let me see your beats. No DJ used to let no DJ look at their beats.
Next item, a big favorite with everybody there, Apache, rendered by the popular group The Shadows.
As the relentless search for obscure beats heated up, it was inevitably cool DJ Herc who discovered the most enduring breakbeat of hip-hop's first decade. And it came from the most unlikely source imaginable. Cover version of The Shadows' hit Apache, recorded by Michael Viner's incredible bongo band, was discovered by Herc in 1975. When he played the record's breakbeat, he energized an audience who had never heard of The Shadows.
Apache was the national anthem of hip-hop when Kool Herc brought that out. But we wasn't calling it Apache, we was calling it The Rock.
Herc had me and Bam going. When he played that song, we was like trying to just look at the label. He kept that quiet for a long time until eventually I found out what it was.
If I have a record right now and I'm playing somewhere else, I wouldn't tell you the name. You have to find out on your own. Because this is where your recognition and your rep come from. You have the record nobody else get.
The B-boys would come to the party. They'll stand on the side, you know, the breakers. And they would just, you know, you're doing your thing. You're throwing on your joints. But they're just waiting for that moment that you just break out with some Apache.
Now that, let me tell you, if you didn't dance to that break, there was something wrong with you. There was something wrong with you.
But DJ supremacy wasn't only about having the best beats. It was also about what you did with them. In their efforts to outdo each other, Bronx DJs began developing a series of revolutionary turntable techniques. Scratching was the most famous of them, a method of stopping the record and rubbing it back and forth against the needle. The trick here was to do it without damaging the vinyl. DJs also began using two copies of the same record, playing them off of each other back and forth to extend the beat. This was known as backspinning.
It was just magical to see somebody extend a piece of a record for like 3 to 4 minutes that you know that was only like a 20-second part in the song. That was magical.
The very last element of hip-hop music to emerge was the skill of rapping. Like the musical style itself, rapping evolved out of a combination of ingenuity and circumstance. At this stage, the term rap was yet to come into existence. Picking up a microphone to speak over a record was simply called MCing.
MCing evolved from the DJ having a microphone to make announcements, to announce when the next party was going to be, where the next party was going to be, who was going to be at the party, you know what I mean? To acknowledge members of the group, members in the crew, or people in the audience.
And I was to call people's name and say, yo, to my Mello Wallace, D, 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 or this is the joint, 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 joint. You never heard it like this before, and playing around with it.
Every DJ, either he did that himself or he had somebody that would make the announcements for him, started to embellish. You know, when they would say things until it grew into sentences, into paragraphs, you know, into verses, you know, into rhymes.
Who are you?
Who am I? 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 I'm Cass.
So what do that mean?
That I'm the baddest MC lover on the hip-hop scene.
It's the Bronx in the house!
MCing was the final element which made the music complete. The next phase in its development was about to begin. But the music itself still lacked a name. By the late 1970s, one would emerge.
People used to just toss it around, hey, little hippity, let's call it little hippity hop. It was the hippity hop. Yeah, little hippity hop guys down there. You know, and then they'd twist around and call, little hip hop guys. Yeah, little hippie parties, little hype parties like that. Then it finally, you know, went that way, went this way, and then up comes hip hop. And that kind of really, that label kind of tagged on it. Hip hop tagged on it, covered the whole scope of the game.
Hip hop, as it was now known, had grown from being a neighborhood pastime into a fully fledged culture and a way of life. Since hip hop was still unrecognized by any record labels, the music existed only in the form of live performance.
Hip-hop is taking the sound system in the park and, you know what I mean, setting it up and playing 5, 6, 7 hours and then tearing it down and taking that sound system home. That was hip-hop, and we did it faithfully because we loved it.
Let's go from party to party. 15 guys packed in the back of a van, speakers, records, turntables, amplifiers. We driving down the highway, set up in Connecticut, rip the party apart, throw all the speakers back in, everybody back in, drive back home, go to sleep, get up the next day, might do the same thing again. But that's the way we do it.
Even though the music was yet to receive recognition from record companies and radio stations, hip-hop had started to travel. From its birthplace in the Bronx, it was spreading into the other boroughs of New York City. DJing and rapping were seizing the imagination of black teenagers in Queens, Brooklyn, and Harlem.
From the parties in the Bronx that Bambaataa and those guys were playing at in the mid-70s, they luckily had the foresight to record almost all the gigs. And these tapes would then become circulated. Like, I would make a copy and give it to you, and you would make a copy and give it to the next cat.
It was all about tapes back then. And in my neighborhood, tapes used to filter in from all the shows that was thrown up in the Bronx at the Audubon Ballroom and all the Harlem World tapes. That used to filter into Queens because a lot of people from Queens used to have to travel outside of our borough to go through these shows.
So it was these cassette tapes that were spreading all through the city. People were getting, the word was getting out, and that's how it all began to spread.
Despite hip-hop's fast appeal in predominantly black neighborhoods on New York's fringes, it was given scant attention in the mainstream and was yet to be acknowledged by record companies. But as the 70s came to a close, all that was about to change. A hip-hop mixtape had found its way to the owner of a small independent label in New Jersey. Impressed by its originality, she decided to produce a hip-hop record and began looking for an MC to rap on it. Her search ended during a chance visit to her local pizza shop. Inside, she heard one of the employees rapping to himself while preparing her food.
I was helping make pizza at the shop, and a woman by the name of Sylvia Robinson came into the pizza shop and they asked me, did I want to make a record? Picture this, I'm in a pizza shop, full of dough, flour all over me, and I'm going to audition to make a record. So I go into the back of her son's 98, and they have a cassette in the car, and I'm rapping along with the track. And she really enjoyed it. She said, okay, I'm going to use you on the record. And a week later, we did it. It was done in one take.
Released in 1979, Rapper's Delight would become an enduring dance floor hit. But despite its massive commercial success, the song was greeted with scorn within the hip-hop community. They thought it was too soft.
When Rapper's Delight first came out, every, you know, traditional rapper was fucking mortified. It was like, what the fuck are they doing with our, you know, with our art form? It's like they axe murdered the shit. So, you know, we didn't think that that was creditable.
I got a color TV so I can see the Knicks play basketball. Him and talking about checkbook, could it cost more money than a sucker could ever spend? But I wouldn't give a sucker off.
Another criticism of Rapper's Delight was that whole sections of Big Hank's lyrics bore an uncanny resemblance to rhymes previously performed by Bronx MC Casanova Fly.
I met Hank at a club called A Sparkle in the Bronx. We kind of clicked. And we used to talk about hip-hop and parties and stuff. He sounded like he had a good head. So I asked him to be down with us. People from Sugar Hill Records came in and he called me. He said, I want to use some of your rhymes. So I'm really not thinking. I'm really not thinking, okay? So I said, okay, all right, well, cool, whatever.
I'm the CASN, the OVA, and the rest is FLY. You see, I go by the code of the doctor of the mix. And these reasons, I'll tell you why.
The C-A-S-N, the O-V-A-N, the rest is F-L-Y. That's my name, spelled out, Casanova Fly. He didn't even change it to say Big Bang Hank or to say, you know, he just said the rhyme the way it was in the book.
I can understand why he would say that. And I have nothing but love for him. I mean, we used a lot of stuff together. I guess he, you know, because he didn't move to that magnitude, or I couldn't bring him in because it was something that Miss Rob had already formatted. But some of the stuff was done together, and I just transposed it over.
At that time, I mean, I had already made a name for myself. People knew me for my rhymes. All right? So people was like, yo, I heard you on the radio. I'm like, yo, that ain't me. Yo, but I heard your rhymes. Yeah, I know. That's not me though. That's Kid Hank. Yo, I know you're getting paid though. Yeah, well, you know, this and that. Yeah, it's fucked me up ever since.
Regardless of its shortcomings, Rapper's Delight exposed hip hop to the mainstream. Hot on its heels came exposure for another aspect of hip hop culture: graffiti. Or tagging. Like hip-hop music and dance, graff painting evolved in the Bronx and thrived in Queens, Brooklyn, and Harlem. But it didn't stay there. The practice of tagging trains transported hip-hop's uncompromising, in-your-face attitude and placed it before an unsuspecting new audience downtown.
The first thing that I noticed coming to New York, I came here in 1978, going to work in Wall Street of all places, chemical bank, a credit analyst. I would go and get in the subway and about to get on a train, and these trains would go by with these amazing burners, you know, graffiti burners, multicolored, you know, name tags that would take up the whole train. And I would watch them go by and just think, my God, this is amazing. And it was the first tug, the first pull into that subculture was, I would have to say, aerosol art or graffiti art.
Having previously been regarded as an eyesore and a public nuisance, graffiti was now making headway as an accepted art form in Manhattan's trendy downtown galleries and studios. In the early 1980s, one of the first graffiti artists to find favor was Fab Five Freddy.
I began to move on the downtown scene in Lower Manhattan and began to meet some of the main people on the downtown new wave scene, new wave punk rock scene. I became close friends with Chris Stein and Deborah Harry, main people in the group Blondie. They would commission me and they bought paintings for me. And I'd say, you know, Debbie, I want you to make a record about me or just mention me on a record, because I want to be like a star. I told her that. I was like, she was like, okay, Freddie. I don't think, and you know, she would laugh. I used to think like, yeah, right, give me a break, you know. And then they made this record called Rapture. I remember going by the house and they sat me down and they played the record, and then they break into this rap. Debbie breaks into this rap. And I'm like, wait a minute. Oh, I thought, oh, this is a complete joke. I thought they'd made a version of this record just as a joke to me. I was like, they're not gonna put out a record where they're trying to rap. I mean, she didn't even sound like a rapper. I could immediately hear what she was saying on the rap though. It was little snippets of stuff I used to tell her. Like, when I would explain the hip-hop scene, I'd be like, well, you know, they got these fly guys and fly girls. Those are like, I guess the equivalent to like punk rockers, you know, like the hardcore fans. And they call the guys fly guys and the girls are fly girls. And then you have this DJ name known as Flash, and he's the fastest. Well, the first line of the rap was Fab Five Freddy told me everybody's fly. DJ Spinning, I said, my, Flash is fast, Flash is cool.
Fab Five Freddy, He used to come to my parties all the time. Was a good friend of Blondie. And he had always told me that he would bring her to the Bronx. And one time he did, chance to meet her. Next thing I know, I heard this crazy rap record by her, my name in it. Cool. And then I used to have a rap that I used to do about how I was born and raised on the planet Mars. I used to chill and rock with the stars till one day I got bored and decided to split. I came to Earth on a rocket ship. So when I heard her rapping and she was like, and the man from Mars, and he shoots you dead and eat you, it was just so crazy. You see me later, as she begins to move around the set, and me and my partner Lee Quinones are on the back wall, kind of like pseudo dancing, pseudo painting. It was pretty cool, actually.
Whereas Rapper's Delight had principally been a regional hit in the New York area, Blondie's Rapture reached the number one position on the US national chart.
I guess for a lot of the white mainstream public, it was the first time that they heard anybody rap. And it kind of paved the way, you can say, for what was about to come.
In the 70s, hip-hop had taken hold on the fringes of New York. But in 1981, Blondie's hip-hop homage, Rapture, had reached the number one position on the US pop chart. People who'd never heard the music before were curious about where it came from. Hip-hop music was now becoming fashionable in the one area of New York where it had never been accepted before, the discos and nightclubs of downtown Manhattan. The man most responsible for this trend was the graffiti artist who'd inspired Rapture, Fab Five Freddy.
The owner of the Mud Club, which was a very famous club in downtown Manhattan scene at the time, had asked me to curate a show of graffiti. And for that exhibition, I put together, you know, a group of some of the dopest heads from the Bronx that were making it happen, you know. Bambada, Cold Crush, Fantastic, Jazzy Five MCs. And the crowd loved it.
Just what Bambata was playing as a DJ completely blew me away. At the time, I was wanting to open up my own club in New York and was looking for something to showcase inside the club. And when I saw this, I was like, oh my God, this is it. I've got to, whatever it is, I've got to put it inside the club.
And she decided to go to a little club on 2nd Avenue right off of 10th Street called The Grill, where she started a little thing. I got involved. I would be like the house MC, talking about so-and-so was in the house and whatever.
Ruza Blue's hip-hop nights at the downtown The Grill Club quickly outgrew the space and moved to a nearby roller rink called the Roxy. The clientele were a curious mix of uptown hip-hop kids and downtown punk rockers.
I think it was a treat for basically both groups of people that they were checking out a completely other cultural group, let's say, and that was really interesting. It was like two groups of people at a zoo looking at each other, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was really amazing.
You come downtown, you see somebody with purple hair sticking up like this, and you know what I'm saying? You'd bug out. In the beginning, you're like, oh, what the hell? But then after a while, you realize, hey, just because he got purple hair, it's all wild, it's not like yours, same person, you know what I'm saying? So we got along with that after a while, no problem.
I think the punks could sort of relate to the, you know, the energy. Because it was very similar. It was very sort of rebellious and, you know, ripping these records up and, you know, not using instruments, only turntables.
The main crowd puller was Africa Bambaataa. His eclectic range of hip-hop beats won him the title Master of Records.
Being known as the master of records, he had all kind of music, and he would like to be able to play certain kind of music for a certain kind of crowd. So when he got to play at the Mud Club, he would throw on his monkey records. I remember this one record, it was like, Mary, Mary, why are you bugging? Mary, Mary. Right? And he would play joints like that. And you'd just be bugging out like, what is this? I mean, Bam Bada, he was incredible.
A lot of the rock records we was taking from, like Fog Hat, Pink Floyd, Led Zeppelin, Billy Squire, the Rolling Stones, even the Beatles, the Monkees. You know, I was playing a lot of crazy stuff.
And so from that experience of him being in a room dominated by young, white, new wave heads, you know, people with, you know, weird haircuts and just super cool beyond belief, you know, were like, wow, we like this, and inspired him to go and make a record called Planet Rock.
Party people, can y'all get funky? So Silent Force, can y'all get funky? The Zulu Nation, can y'all get funky? Yeah, just hit me. Just taste the funk.
Released in 1982, Planet Rock became the fastest-selling 12-inch single ever and established a new platform for hip-hop. It was released by a tiny new independent label called Tommy Boy Records, which was the creation of a music journalist called Tom Silverman.
I went to hear Bam Bada DJ, and afterwards I talked to him. I said, so, like, you're putting all these records together, why don't we make a record? Because I had started a label in case, you know, I found something really interesting. Let's put a demo together, let's make a record that uses like some of these records you're cutting up.
And I was telling Tom, you know, I said, you know, with all this electronic music I was playing, I said, there's no black electronic group. I said, I want this sound as something like Kraftwerk, because I was deep into Kraftwerk, Yellow Magic Orchestra, Gary Numan.
To the studio called Intergalactic, and they kind of didn't know their lines that well. They had sort of had them written down, but they weren't memorized that well. And Pow Wow had one section, and he couldn't remember his words. So he went, z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-z-
True to hip-hop's DJ tradition of taking breakbeats from existing records, Planet Rock blended melodies from half a dozen songs. One of them was Trans Europe Express by the German band Kraftwerk.
We got sued by Kraftwerk's publishing company. We paid an ungodly amount of a royalty per record that we sold.
But even being sued by Kraftwerk couldn't diminish Planet Rock's stature as the first hip-hop record to win both crossover pop success and grassroots credibility.
Planet Rock was just some whole new shit. You know what I'm saying? Planet Rock opened up a whole nother world of music. It exposed another audience to hip-hop, and it started merging those two audiences.
It was one of the first records that really crossed over the barriers into the pop sphere and really brought hip-hop worldwide.
Hip-hop's newfound success in the record industry only intensified the competitiveness of the old days. While Bambaataa was reveling in his breakthrough at Tommy Boy, his old rivals Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five were about to release a record on the Sugar Hill label that would raise hip-hop's rising stature a notch higher.
Planet Rock was like the hottest fucking record at that time. I mean, you heard it everywhere, and I was like, if somebody could just get a record that could knock off Planet Rock. And when the message came out, I knew we was gonna knock Planet Rock off.
And we gonna tell y'all about New York City. We love it over there, and this is what it's like. We gonna tell y'all about this. We got broken glass everywhere. People pissing on the stairs. You know they just don't care. I can't take the smell, can't take the noise. Got no money to move out. I guess I got no choice.
Released in July 1982, The Message was the rawest form of rap yet put on record. A song with adult themes that demanded to be taken seriously.
The Message was kind of a puzzle to everybody when it first came out. It's like, The putting out this slow song in a time where, you know what I'm saying, everything is kind of upbeat, up-tempo, whatever. But the content of the message is what caught everybody.
Don't push me, cause I'm close to the edge, and I'm trying not to lose my head.
Anybody could have said, you know, even don't push me because I'm close to the edge, I'm trying not to lose my head. At that time, anybody could have said that. You know, at that time, you know, half the people in America probably wanted to say that. And then when the record came out, it was like, somebody said this shit. Here it is.
Unlike most of its predecessors, The Message used specially composed music. It was written by Ed Fletcher, a former schoolteacher turned record producer at Sugar Hill, who went by the nickname of Duke Booty. He wrote the song at the piano in the basement of his mother's house in suburban New Jersey.
Came down here, actually here, you know, which is like pianos, the piano. I got the ba-ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba on, and I just kept playing it and came up with verses for that. It's like a jungle sometimes, you know, broken glass everywhere. I mean, if you look around the neighborhood, you kind of see things were going on, and I created this track.
Fletcher did the track. It was his idea. He did the track from top to bottom. He did the music. We helped with the music. I came up with the ba-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da- this and this and that and that, even though Fletcher was the main theme writer. He brought it all in there.
I think if you have a good idea, you could damn near beat on some cardboard and snap some rubber bands and people will respond to it. You know, and if it's funky enough, you make Lassie dance with it.
But the message almost never happened. When Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five were first offered the song, they didn't want to record it.
Everybody was doing party music. So it was like, nah, this is not, you know, this is a little bit too serious. You know, we don't know if our fans are getting into something like this. And nobody wanted to do it.
In the end, Melly Mel was the only member of the Furious Five who took part in recording the song.
I wrote the part "A Child Is Born With No State of Mind," the very last very last rhyme that was on the message.
A child is born with no state of mind, blind to the ways of mankind. God is smiling on you, but he's frowning too, because only God knows what you'll go through. You'll grow in the ghetto, live a second rate. Your eyes will sing a song, because he hates the places you play and where you stay. Looks like one great big alleyway. You'll admire
the owners of the Sugar Hill label decided to release the message under the name Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five because they felt the group's image was right for the song. But it was only after the message was a hit that the group really accepted the song. And even then, Grandmaster Flash himself was less than happy.
It was the first record for Flash, and where the whole Flash wasn't going to be on the record. Flash isn't even on the record.
From a public's point of view, it was like the incredible record. But from what I believe in, it's extremely important that I do things that allow me to show people who I am, not as a group figure, but as an individual. And that's the biggest problem I had with that record.
At one time, his name was known all over the world just from being on a record that he didn't even do nothing off. He should be happy. I wish I could have been on every record and didn't do nothing in there with just Melly Mel on the record and everyone. Oh yeah, there goes Melly Mel. I mean, what did you do? I didn't do a fucking thing. I'm famous, hey. You know what I mean? Could you write me a check? You know what I mean? Shit. You know?
Ironically, the message was the last song recorded by the group. They split up 6 months later. But the impact of the message, combined with the earlier success of Planet Rock, had awoken the music industry to the commercial potential of hip-hop. Over the next decade, hip-hop would grow to dominate the pop charts, but it would also become the most notorious and controversial music in America.
The story continues tomorrow at 10 past midnight. Now, hip-hop is just one of the many things that have shaped and changed life here in England. If you'd like a chance to create a free website about the other influences, visit channel4.com/insight. Next up, top techniques for a couple with mismatched libidos from The Sex Inspectors.